get stronger as the days go by. Some things I wish they would last just a little bit longer as the days go by.
All your films, some of the movies, in particular feature films, do you ever sneak into a public screening and have a little look and look, check the reaction? Have you ever been inspired to do that?
You do, because you just want to see if people are either laughing in the right spots or reacting in some way. Of course, in the United States, they have screenings where you know they'll bring in an audience and then they'll ask them to write something down and say it's very intense. But I have done it. I might say I don't re-watch my work.
No.
Because I always look at it going, I wished I had have done.
Because you know how it was made.
I wished I had have done.
Yeah.
Film is always finished. Every film, really, as a work in progress. It's just got to stop.
Well,
there.
As they
Lots
say,
more you can do.
We never finish editing. They just take it away from us.
Yeah.
You got a deadline and it's there. What was it like? I mean, you made two films. One was Robinson Crusoe, based on one of the greatest novels ever written, Daniel Defoe. The other was December Boys. Both included actors. Pierce Brosnan in one and
Daniel Radcliffe
in the other.
Yeah.
Both in the height of their portrayals of their most famous characters.
Yeah.
One was James Bond, the other was Harry Potter. What were the reactions like at that time, seeing from critics and viewers, seeing those actors in those roles?
Bronson was only announced as Bond when it was released.
When
Crusoe was released.
That's exactly
and that
right.
Really boosted it.
No. Brosnan was already in GoldenEye in 1995.
No, we did Robinson Crusoe, and while we were in just before we got into pre-production, he got the Bond pictures.
So we
shot the Bond. We shot Robinson Crusoe, and then he went off to do the Bond movie.
Ah. Yeah. And it boosted that image greatly.
So you already had Robinson Crusoe footage
in the can
in 95.
The reason why Robinson Crusoe ever got going, I might say, is because Robert Helmy, the producer, wanted to make every classic film you could think of that he didn't have to pay the copyright for.
Right. Okay.
So he'd picked everything from Treasure Island through.
Because Robinson Crusoe had been adapted by quite a few film
Everybody has tried to make a successful film. It's a very hard film to make.
Two
men on an island.
Yeah.
Is a challenge. I think The Martian is very much Robinson Crusoe.
Mm.
And
probably,
you notice they have to keep going away to other things to keep the story, for me, to keep the story alive.
Just on Robinson Crusoe, I mean, I had a bit of an issue with that. The whole title is Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe. Daniel Defoe is in the movie, as you know, Top and Tail It. Mm. Well, you made it.
That was
and
a nice
also,
addition.
It's based on his book, of course, and yet so many major things have changed. Like, he was on the island for 6 years, not 30 years. You know what I'm talking about. Friday didn't die. In the book, so many things were major.
What Robert Helmy would do is to find every way to make it feel bigger and more important. And Daniel Defoe,
make it cinematic.
In a sense, is, if you remember rightly what happened with Robinson Crusoe, we were about to start pre-production. I'd met Pierce, we got on really well, and he was going to be in the project, and he got Bond. And it went from being a $1 million license fee TV movie for CBS, turned it into a feature film with Miramax.
On the strength of his Bond.
And with no increase in budget.
That's incredible.
And not only was there no increase in budget, Robert Telmy wanted to shoot it in New Guinea.
Oh, wow. It was shot in New Guinea?
We shot it in New Guinea.
Wow.
I remember he asked me to do it after having done The Yearling for him.
Yeah.
He then wanted me to do a picture he did in Africa about a prisoner of war camp that was made with Rachel Ward was in that one.
Yeah, Rachel Ward.
And they
Ward.
Ended up escaping over the mountaintops, and there were elephants in the snow and all that sort of stuff. And I read the script and I thought, this is really not a very good project. Yeah, I won't do it. When you say no to Robert Helmer, he would always come back. And then I read Defoe's Robinson Crusoe, and I went, it's still not, for me, it is literature, which is something we all should read, but it isn't like gripping material.
You got
to
change.
So how do we make this work in that period? So I eventually said, no, I won't do it. And he said, well, come with me on a trip. Where would you like to go? Where would you like to film it? I mean, what do you do with that? We went to Thailand, Phuket. Mm-hmm. We went to far north Queensland. We went to the Philippines.
Everywhere.
We went to New Guinea, but he chose New Guinea because he was a Hungarian freedom fighter who loved the challenge of making films.
And also,
but he didn't
apparently,
have the money. He didn't have the money to do it.
Really?
Yeah. And so, you also co-directed it with George Miller, not that George Miller.
What happened?
Not that George Miller. Not
the other George Miller.
He did Man from Snowy River.
He did Man from Snowy River.
And you guys worked together on quite a few TV shows, like
back in the old days.
Yeah. Homicide.
George took over the project for me because what happened was two thirds into the film. The Pierce Brosnan and I, and the wonderful William Takaku, who played Friday.
Mm-hmm.
We had our trailers, which were thatched roof huts, three of them, on the back of a semi-trailer. They put steps to go up to our trailers that were tied with jungle vines, and they were made by the locals. Mm-hmm. And we'd drive this truck through the jungles to get to our locations, and it had an air conditioner in it, and everybody would want to be in it. So, of course, everybody was up and down my stairs and in my trailer. And on one particular occasion late at night, I was called to the set, and I came out, and I was standing on the steps, and there were two other people standing on the bottom of the steps, and somebody else came out from behind me, and it collapsed.
Oh, no.
And I hit the deck and knocked myself out and created I was flown off by the Australian Army to Darwin for a couple of days, and I came back, and I was on the sets, and the natives were carrying me around in a sedan chair. It was too much of an experience. Anyway, but Helmy decided that his insurance company were not happy with me being in New Guinea. So George Miller was flown in to take over the project. Hence the reason why there's double credits on.
So it's not a co-direction. So he did one bit, then you did the next.
And then what's decided by the director's guild is how do you share that?
Exactly.
And I knew George, and
you have a vision.
Fine with me. But I might say I did the hard bits, getting it started.
Did he? Thank you for that.
Oh, of course, of course.
You know, your style of directing would have suited something like Remington Steele as well.
Yeah, Brosnan.
Because the way you weave genres so effortlessly together.
Yeah.
Romance, adventure.
Pierce is that was a good character.
He was a good character. He was offered character. To play Bond long before he actually played him.
And do you know that Pierce's late wife Cassandra was one of the Bond girls?
Yeah.
And became very friendly with Barbara Broccoli.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
And so it was through that relationship too that Pierce was being considered. And now Barbara and Pierce are still very, very dear friends.
Wow.
So
yeah.
It's great. I mean, that's what. And Pierce.
And what's Pierce like?
He's wonderful. And there's a madness in him too. I think that's. We tried to get that out in Crusoe, and there's
Crusoe
a couple of scenes where there's moments of that. I just wished we were able to. It was made so quickly. It was being made for a TV movie, and they wanted it to be a feature. They didn't want it to pay any more money. But every time Robert Helmy would say, "Just shoot the shit," there'd be a message from Miramax, from Harvey Weinstein, saying, "Make it bigger, make it bigger."
Yeah.
So suddenly we had these pygmies on an island off that were coming in their hundreds, and it got bigger, and there was
changed.
No more money.
So
it made it a little challenging, and it went from being something like a 14-day shoot up to about a 28-day shoot.
Yeah.
So it was you could never really plan it, but that's what filmmaking is.
But what have you
ever co-directed someone and you had to share the direction? You have a vision of what you're doing, and that's yours, or his, or hers.
You know, I've never done it, but I would very much enjoy that experience.
Yeah.
Because I think there's a way. You watch a lot of these double directors who are usually brothers. They know each other so well.
But you and Miller kind of grew up together.
Yeah, we did. Crawford days.
So you knew each other. You knew how you thought. And,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we went through that Crawford Productions School of film and television making.
What a factory!
It was an extraordinary factory, and I got to tell you, the best learning.
That's the
experience.
Best training ground.
People ask me, what would you suggest to get into the business. I said, get a job.
I mean, get a job.
Get a job and do anything. You know, just get in and start to smell the smells and start to meet the personalities and start to understand.
Experience.
And of course, were involved in Australia's greatest international TV series, Prisoner.
I was, yeah. I did the second episode.
That is
And many others afterwards. I was always the bridesmaid in these things. I did the second episode.
The bridesmaid.
I did the second episode of Sullivan's.
Yeah. And came in on the end of X-Files, too.
I came in at the last two seasons. It was season six, seven. I think there was eight seasons.
Eight, yeah.
And Battlestar Galactica in 2000.
I enjoyed that a lot.
Wow.
Michael Reimer did the pilot. He was an Australian director friend. And then I came in and did episode three. And what a great experience. Yeah, and what a great show. And that
did you work with Edward James Olmos?
Yes.
Such an amazing actor.
Yeah. We're all still close friends. I mean, that group of people stuck together quite nicely.
He's a bit of a philanthropist.
He does all of that stuff. He's a very caring, nurturing human being. Is
And he always plays gangsters in all these movies, you know?
It's that pockmarked face.
Yeah.
Just back on X-Files, what's your thoughts on the new one coming out this year, the reboot?
Do you know what? I'm excited to see it. It's got Gillian and David in it, and I think it's six episodes they're doing. Mm-hmm. I think they're just trying it out. They've tried with the feature films.
Three of them?
They did three of those, and I don't know if they actually have spread themselves big in the marketplace, but they're trying it as a series again. And it'll be interesting, because I think it had a rawness when it first started. They were shooting it in Vancouver. It was cold.
Back to the original.
It was, it was. Then they moved it to LA, where I worked on it, because David wanted to be back closer to his family, etc.
Yeah.
And it changed its flavor one more time.
It did.
But I'm looking forward to it. And
Chris Carter
is a fabulous writer.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be something really interesting. And I worked with Vince Gilligan on X-Files. He then went on to do Breaking Bad.
Vince Gilligan is?
He was the writer and now producer of Breaking Bad. There was a good bunch of people. Frank Spotnitz, who was also an executive producer on it, did another series I did called Robbery Homicide Division that Michael Mann directed.
Yeah.
Crazy Tom. I can't think of his name now. How interesting! But they were challenging series. It was the first digital series,
wow.
So the camera equipment was really large,
sophisticated,
but very large. And we shot it all on location, shot it all nights, in tiny little parts of Compton and every bad
the most
part
dangerous
of,
area,
every bad part of LA you could imagine.
Yeah. What is it like to come onto a set of a TV show that is well established? And to just kind of take over, and what is the turnaround time for an episode, for example?
They're on average 7 days. You do 8 day preparation, 7 day shoot.
Okay.
Then you get 4 days to edit that piece as per the DGA.
Wow. And how many editors are involved?
There's probably three or four, but one will work on each episode.
Okay.
And it's 7 days is the average, but I just finished a show called Powers.
Yeah.
That was 10 days because it's a very big show and they're trying to reboot it as Powers is being made for Sony PlayStation.
Yes.
They've had one season and now they're rebooting it into a second season, making it bigger and better and more adventurous with visual effects and stunts like you cannot believe.
But this doesn't have anything to do with a game.
No, not at all.
Right. So
it's to do with a comic book in the 80s called Powers.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of fun. It's actually a lot of fun. But what to answer your question? As a director coming onto a new show where you haven't worked there before, there's 100 people waiting for you to fail.
Well, they're all sitting there.
You walk on the show. Well, it's only because you've come onto the set and they're a family.
Yeah.
And you've got to fit into the family. So it's a matter of trying to work out what is required from the producers and a style that they're looking for. But I've worked with some great producers, so they give you a chance to do your own thing, but within that sort of format.
With the lack that a bit in Lies and Lullabies, were they sort of, or were they just giving more free reign?
They
with
the
freshness,
in all the TV movies, they were fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they were fantastic.
That's
they
because
allowed
you're
you
with them from the beginning to the very end.
But that's a movie. Where in TV series, and particularly shows like Supernatural or. They've been running for certain seasons, and I come on to do an episode, and you've got a family of people that know each other. But I love that challenge.
Yeah.
You've got to get in there and do as well as anybody else can do, and get it shot on time, because that's the key to it, and make sure it's good.
Now, Rod, tell us, about the Hoff in Nick Fury.
Yeah,
Agents
you
of
made
Shield.
A Marvel movie.
I did.
A really cool Marvel movie.
I did.
Was that meant to be a comedy? Or?
Yes, it was meant to be a comedy. Thank goodness.
No, but I mean, it's like a Escape from New York. It's got that Snake Plissken look and feel to it.
Yeah.
And in my opinion, David Hasselhoff's portrayal of Nick Fury is far superior to Samuel Jackson's.
Do you know what? I agree with that. And I think Samuel Jackson's a great actor.
Yeah,
but I think
what
David could bring was his personality.
Yeah.
And I think David is Nick Fury.
Absolutely.
Without the iPad.
And I think what made Escape from New York and even Star Wars with Han Solo so interesting and fun is that they didn't take themselves so seriously.
Yeah.
And then when you watch someone like Samuel Jackson's portrayal, it's the same character. He brings a real serious tone.
An edge, but I think that's what's happening. Yeah. It's like James Bond has changed.
Exactly.
I think the edge is going to have to be pulled back somewhat because I think we're all getting a little. We want to
people go to the
more
movies.
Fun
they want
for
to escape.
A release. Yeah. Exactly right.
I was just wondering, Gord, are you friends with some of your contemporaries from
that are over
the,
there?
The era. Yeah, the 70s era where you guys...
Oh, yeah, of course, we'll stick around.
Yeah.
There's a group here that turn up every now and then called the Curmudgeons.
The Curmudgeons.
Curmudgeons.
That's with Fred Skepsi and David Parker and, a bunch of the others.
Were you friends with, like, Richard Franklin?
Oh, yeah, dear Richard, absolutely.
Yeah.
No, people still, you know, we're all in the trenches. Everyone is trying to do their best to get a film. And it's difficult now to get a film financed, but I've got to tell you, right back then, it was a tough, tough job.
Absolutely.
And I respect so many. I mean, Nadia and David have done some extraordinary work around the world.
And they're married. How can they have done
How do they do that bloody thing?
Yeah.
Absolutely right.
All the work you've done, your large body of work in television and films and everything, what's the one film, TV, that you think is your legacy? Which would come to mind you think is, this is my...
Oh, goodness me. You know, I got to tell you, I love doing The Yearling and I love doing December Boys. I might say, and each of them I can see the flaws in every way, but there is a tale about coming of age and growing up, and maybe because I haven't grown up properly yet, but I get attracted to those kind of stories. And both of them, cinematically, I think their personality is made up very much of the surroundings and the atmosphere. We had in The Yearling scenes that were just people walking along on horses and talking, and I found the location that was like a big pond that had those fabulous cypress trees.
Where was that?
And it was in South Carolina.
Okay.
And we put them in a barge with a pole. Dad had the pole. The kid was sitting in the thing with the deer.
Yeah.
So the scenes were suddenly in this absolutely extraordinary location, rather than a horse going clop, clop, clop.
It felt like you were on a journey.
And it was a journey, and I love the fact that that nature became part of the storytelling.
Oh, yeah. What did you find attractive about Under Capricorn? Were you an Alfred Hitchcock fan? Was there... something, the story that kind of drew
everybody
you to it,
who's a filmmaker is an Alfred Hitchcock fan.
Yeah.
I mean, he's
he
truly is the person from a director's perspective. And I remembered seeing the film and wondered why he made it.
Mm. Yeah.
Because the story was not one that was anything like him.
And why he made it with backdrops, as he usually did in his films.
But he also did it to be able to have those long shots that would go on to the longest shot in history. Mm-hmm. You know, and so I think from my perspective, I looked at that, I read the book, and again I went, I'm still not sure, but there was something about that sort of the darkness of the relationship between the two main characters played by Lisa Harrow
But you made it closer to the book than he did. His adaptation was very much like Rebecca.
Mm. Yeah.
It was too similar to his film
Rebecca.
Yes,
it was. You know what, the original script for our miniseries was done by Tony Morfitt,
and a
wonderful writer, and has done some amazing Australian movies and television. Tony managed to capture the book without question. That was his choice, not mine. I took on the project and became the director of the miniseries. But
it had to have been made by an Australian because we understand the culture better.
Yeah,
people often get it wrong.
but you know what? Hitchcock made it. I made it. Yeah. I made High Noon. You know, Zimmerman made High Noon.
Yeah.
We all as directors come in to do whatever we can do, and I wished I had made the originals of all of those things.
Yeah.
If I have the chance to do anything, to follow on from some master's work and do my little part of that,
But the thing is, you can't say Zimmerman did the original or Hitchcock did the original because they're all based on novels. Mm. So the original is actually the novel.
Yeah.
Well,
Hitchcock just gave it a film treatment.
The original film.
Yeah.
Yes.
So what you're really doing is you're not remaking Hitchcock, you're remaking the book.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Yeah. It's interesting what you say, though. That. One of your favorite films, The Yearling, because it's such a simple, totally sad, tear-jerking story. And to have that simple little TV film is one of your favorites.
It's, and it's only because of the experience of making it was such a good one.
Yeah.
And Peter Strauss played the main role. Jean Smart, who's a wonderful American actress, and then a young kid called Will Horner, who went on to do other things. It was just a good experience. Yeah. Philip Seymour Hoffman was part of that.
Mm. And you know, when I watched December Boys with...
Now, Daniel's different.
Radcliffe. Daniel's amazing.
And by the way, I might say to something, and as proud as I am of the film, we had a problem bringing Daniel into the film.
Why was there a problem getting him
in? It was an... look, this is my heart that I'll reveal for 1 second, but it's true. The film was produced, and it was meant to be a small film and get made very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love the idea of it, but I didn't think it would take 11 years.
Mm-hmm.
We finally got Daniel Radcliffe into the film, and with the great support of Graham Burke from Village Roadshow.
Yeah.
But what happened when we got Daniel... Warner's had the interest in the film because they had the Harry Potter pictures.
Of course.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So and then in my movie, you know, the character has his first sexual experience.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, and one of the reviewers from Variety magazine, I think she said it was Harry Potter gets laid.
You know, so in a sense that can be
that
a plus
makes all
or minus.
The papers.
But the point about it is, let's still stick with that story and stick with what's real for the characters. That boy was going through puberty, coming of age. Very important things. Warner's tried to make changes to the film because they didn't want Harry Potter to be going out there doing stuff like this.
They didn't want him to get laid.
Of course not.
So
they don't want Harry Potter
from my perspective,
the whole film.
Some people will tell me this isn't correct, but the film didn't get a fair chance in the United States because they didn't want the film to be seen. We didn't even get into the Australian Film Awards because people forgot to put it up.
That's terrible. They do that.
Yeah.
And
the
I know politics. That seems controversial to say so, but you know that's a challenge, and it was a challenge. And it was a real shame because a lot of the people involved in the film, including those four boys, didn't get the chance to show their wares to the audience.
Absolutely.
That's sad.
But
it's so tough to be typecast. I mean,
it's filmmaking.
Jason Alexander played George Costanza in Seinfeld. He can't find work since then.
He has not been able to find work.
He's a great magician.
The
thing about December Boys, which I thought also, it's also a travelogue for Australia. I mean, those locations in Kangaroo Island were just stunning, remarkable.
And you know, there was another one of the...
For me,
why I enjoyed making the film, I saw it with that sort of backdrop. And unfortunately at the time, because of budget and all the other issues, they wanted me to shoot it on Glenelg Beach.
Oh.
Yeah.
In Adelaide.
Adelaide,
and
yeah.
I said, but it's the 60s and we're going to have Daniel Radcliffe. Can you imagine the boats out there, the cameraman wanting? But also all the houses around were not 60s.
Mm.
So I stuck with it and stuck. It was a challenge that we finally got to shoot on an island like Kangaroo Island.
Why do they have a problem with that? Expensive.
It's cost.
Yeah,
I mean, everything is costly to get a crew onto an island, and I totally respect that.
Yeah.
But without that, the film has nothing.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
It was such a feature of the film.
I hope it helped the tourism of Kangaroo Island.
Well, I call films like that travelogues. You see these shots, you see these incredible locations. You just want to go there. Did you go? I didn't notice. Did you go to one of the most best beaches? Bad English. One of the best beaches in Australia. Vivonne Beach, is it?
On Kangaroo Island?
Yeah.
Oh, I went right around. Yes, I did. They're extraordinary.
I didn't notice where it was filmed there, but there could have been a location.
I would recommend to go there if I was an Australian. Go and see Kangaroo Island. It is extraordinary.
It's great. Yeah, it really is good.
Best kept secret.
Mm, not wrong.
And I love the ending with Max Cullen playing the older version.
Some people thought that was controversial too. They felt he was too old and too old looking, and the dates didn't match up. And
it was 30 years later. Hello.
That's a movie about friendship.
Yeah.
And that was
beautiful. It's like Stand By Me.
Yes.
It reminded me a lot of Stand By Me and The Sandlot. And
thank you. A lot of reviewers said that same thing. I appreciate that because they were two great movies too.
You see this story and you watch development, and it just came together so well when those old guys poured the ashes.
Yeah,
and it just all made sense.
Oh, it's a great Christmas
friendship,
movie.
You're right.
That's a good idea.
And that's when I saw it for Christmas.
Good.
All right, guys.
Good.
Are we done?
Thank you. We're done. Thank you.
Awesome.
That was fun, guys.
Thank you so much, Rob.
Hey, listen, it's my pleasure.
Really
good luck with
it.
I hope you get out of it what you want.
Are we leaving together?
Okay.
Let's leave together.
Thinking about you, I And I remember everything, all of us. The time of open hearts, the time before the rest of life begins, the love.